Is in the same fashion going to be presented to you just like the League of Nations. It's going to be a mixture of both historical information as well as comparative theoretical analysis. The Cold War is important for IR studies because it is probably the one phenomenon that is mostly responsible for setting the stage, for setting the structure of the international system up to the present time. We still refer to the current period as the post-Cold War period, even though we're now 25 years on from there, but we still haven't figured out what else to call this time period. But you know, the nature of the Cold War, the alliance systems that formed between the United States and the Soviet Union, the expansion of power between not only the US and the Soviet Union, but also among emerging countries within those alliance systems, still widely affects the way in which the international world is shaped today. And even though we could say that the United States definitively won the Cold War, considering that the Soviet Union collapsed and the United States is still here, what we end up looking at are a lot of residual leftover effects from that, as we're going to be seeing next week and the week after when we look at theories of globalization, expanding natures of warfare, and of course when we finish up this semester on global terrorism. So it stands to reason that we should look at the origins of all of this. It stands to reason that we kind of look at the setting. Here we are, May, June 1945. The Second World War has come to an end in Europe, and it is becoming a definitive end in the Pacific campaign. The first thing that we note is that Europe is now divided between two conquering powers. The United States coming in from the west, and the Soviet Union marching in from the east. Both sides meet in Germany, and for the next 45 years, Europe is divided between two spheres of influence, the United States in the west, the Soviet Union in the east. These are the only two remaining superpowers, at least as early as 1950. All other major powers have been either defeated or their resources have been definitively exhausted by 1950. Great Britain ceases to be a global power. France's global footprint is removed with the French going kicking and screaming. The United States emerges more powerful than it has ever been beforehand and becomes the definitive superpower, at least as far as Western Europe and the Atlantic is concerned. On the other end of the coin, the Soviet Union becomes the undisputed hegemon in not only Eastern Europe, but throughout Central Asia. And while it's difficult to say whether or not the Soviet Union had the same military, industrial, and economic capabilities as the United States, hint, hint, they did not, they did have a significant global presence. And there was absolutely no way that the Red Army could be dislodged from its presence in Eastern Europe without another war. In fact, most historians today will kind of retroactively argue that in order to defeat Nazi Germany, the United States and Great Britain had to ally with Stalin, right? That was just a no-brainer. In a parallel universe, it wasn't Germany that invaded Poland, but it was Russia that invaded Poland. Whatever universe we're talking about, Poland is just going to get invaded, okay? But in said parallel universe, it would have required an alliance with Hitler's Germany in order to defeat the Soviet Union. So it was somewhat of a pyrrhic victory in the sense that Nazism is defeated, but Stalin's Soviet Union emerges as one of the victorious powers and has significant rights to lay claim to a number of peace agreements afterwards. They sit on the Nuremberg trials, they end up taking vast quantities of German resources back to the Soviet Union, and as we know, up until the 1990s, most of the countries that the Soviet Union had liberated from the Nazis came with the added bonus of a ready-to-use communist government that by the 1950s was all but complete. So with that setting, an initial look at Europe during the Cold War is very much divided along ideology, but yet is structured along classic realist models of realpolitik. Ideology is one thing that some people argue created the divisions between the United States and the Soviet Union, right? The United States on one side calling for democracy and the free market, Soviet Union calling for command economies and communism. Realists would say that ideology really does not play that much of a factor in the idea that you effectively have two countries, the United States and the Soviet Union, that have two superior military forces and capabilities, which are operating and occupying pretty much most of Europe. As such, the bipolar system of power balance is going to be a non-starter, right? That's going to be guaranteed. In that case, classic realism dominates some of the earlier stages of the Cold War. When we augment that power balance by nuclear power, it becomes even more apparent. Right? Again, by 1950, not only does the United States have access to nuclear weapons, but so does the Soviet Union. When we talk about deterrence, it is painfully obvious that countries with nuclear capabilities serve as major deterrents against any thought of extending conflict to those regions, right? Nuclear deterrence was shown by what actually happened that ended the Japanese campaign in 1945. The thought that either the United States or the Soviet Union could not only destroy a good chunk of the world, but effectively take us back to the Stone Age, was enough of a sobering reminder that any slight disruption in this power balance could create the necessary chain reactions to lead us to war. As you remember, or if you at least read in history, we came as close as possible to that in the 1960s under what particular event? The Cuban Missile Crisis. And we came almost, this is the closest that we came to a full-blown nuclear war with the Soviet Union. So it stands to once again understand that we can look at the Cold War historically through a number of settings. The classic and most obvious way is to look at it through the realist paradigm, which neorealists like Waltz, Mearsheimer, Lane, Jervis, and others basically cornered the market as far as US foreign policy and strategic studies were concerned from the 50s up to the 80s. Again, it's not that hard to see why. The division of the, not only European theater, but the quick division of the world into really two spheres of influence shows us that a bipolar balance system was in effect for at least 45 years. Sometimes that bipolar system began to thaw and relations became a bit more amicable. Other times, US and Soviet relations deteriorated to levels in which we hope never happen again. Cuban Missile Crisis being one, but that was just one among a number of cases where relations deteriorate. Within this bipolar balance structure, we see the active functioning of security dilemmas, not only by the United States, but also from the Soviet Union. Neither side really knowing what the other one is going to do, nor having an idea of what their ultimate grand scheme is. Europe remained largely pacified from 45 onward. That's probably the one big thing that we can get, is that up to the 1990s, Europe had not witnessed any conflict since World War II. That doesn't mean that conflict didn't happen elsewhere, Southeast Asia, Africa, the Middle East, Latin America, and among other places. Most of these were triggered by security dilemmas. The other thing that we note, especially when looking at it from a very broad macro-analytical view, national security, especially from US foreign policy, national security and national interest took precedence over America's interest, if they ever had an interest, in spreading the concepts of democracy and the free market. You have to understand, the United States' foreign policy really took two tiers as far as the Cold War was concerned. First tier dealt with US relations with Western Europe, and that was preserving the ideas of free market capitalism and democracy. But when it came to the rest of the world, particularly America's sphere of influence of Latin America. And we'll see this as early as the late 50s, and it becomes painfully obvious by the 1970s.
U.S. foreign policy made that very fateful decision about what type of state to support, a government that was pro-Western or a government that was pro-democracy. More often than not, they're going to choose governments that are pro-Western. They may not be democratic at all. The United States does make a number of strategic alliances during the Cold War, even today, with countries that are far from being democratic, but they are pro-Western. They get American money, and in return, they support American diplomacy. So the realists look at this and say, okay, there's nothing wrong there. America and its key partners, Great Britain, France, and others, are looking out for their own interests, and they're looking to shore up their national security. Democracy and the free market are simply add-ons afterwards, right? Make sure that you get the cement foundations built, make sure that you get the walls built up. Once the walls are built up, once we get guard posts along those walls, you can play with monopoly money afterwards. But the first thing that we need to do is shore up national security and also ensure our national interests. On the other end of the token, liberalists are going to look at the Cold War and say, well, that may explain the initial structure of the Cold War system, but it doesn't explain how, and more specifically, why the Cold War ended the way that it did. You know, one of the things that 99% of you in this room will never experience is the notion that at some point, and tell me, did you ever have air raid drills in school? Air raid drills were fun. Okay, we had fire drills. Actually, air raid drills were annoying. Fire drills were cool because we could go outside. Air raid drills, you know what we used to do with air raid drills? Duck and cover under our desks. Because the desks of our school and maybe the lead paint and the asbestos would protect us from the nuclear fallouts or whatever it happened to have been, right? If we had a more developed school, we actually had fallout shelters that we would go down into, but they ended up becoming storage units by the time I was in the second grade, so we didn't do that, right? The point that I'm trying to make here is that liberalists kept saying, look, nobody expected the Cold War to end the way that it did. How did the Cold War end? How did the Cold War end? Yeah, pretty much. I mean, if you want to get cliche here, I mean, it didn't end in Guts and Glory. It didn't end in a major, you know, Iron Eagle Rambo movie. It just, I mean, the Soviet Union just kind of, stopped being the Soviet Union. Communism was just kind of like, okay, we kind of ran out of gas. And for those of you that were in my comparative politics class yesterday, you remember how bureaucratic authoritarian states, you know, kind of stop? The old people are like, I don't want to do this anymore. Let's just retire, right? Now, the thing is that liberalists will point to it and say, well, there's reasons behind that. The reasons were largely because, look, the United States may have been a global hegemon, okay? But the strategic alliances that the United States created were also based on common ideologies. If not democracy, definitely the free markets, you know? The optimist is going to say, oh, who won the Cold War? Thomas Jefferson or Karl Marx? Thomas Jefferson won the Cold War, along with John Locke. Democracy wins, right? The realist, the more, you know, rationalist, are going to say, no, Thomas Jefferson didn't win the Cold War. Adam Smith won the Cold War. In fact, Adam Smith wins every argument, okay? Adam Smith, you know, just wins all of the arguments. And look, that's not a bad thing. The thing here is that the notion of a free market, the notion of transatlantic trade, understandings of commercial pacifism and democratic peace theory were, in fact, very agreeable and very attractive strategies. If not for the developing world, definitely for Europe. Because the Cold War began in Europe and it ended in Europe. To be even more specific, the Cold War began in Germany and ended in Germany. Do you want to get even more specific? The Cold War began in Berlin and ended in Berlin, all right? If it ends there, that's the shatter points. The developing world just simply follows along. But the big thing that we note is that by the mid to late 1980s, single-party communist planned economies in Eastern Europe can no longer compete with the market economies of the West. It is not tanks and guns and bombs and planes that win the Cold War for the United States, but it's blue jeans, Mickey Mouse, Coca-Cola, rock and roll, Elvis Presley, and Disney World. Like, that's what wins. The idea that I want the crap that America has. I'm tired of cheap knockoff Soviet stuff. America makes cars that look good and they go fixed. The Soviet Unions, they make cars. You get you from point A to point B, what do you want, all right? So with that in mind, the neoliberalists are going to look at this and say, well, the Cold War is certainly more understandable through a liberal policy. So you can look at it both ways. You can check it out through a realist concept. You can look at it through a liberalist concept. At the risk of giving the plot away, I'm going to make the argument that you can probably look at the whole darn thing through the lens of constructivism. Now that we've come out of the midterm, constructivism kind of answers everybody's questions because they provide something for everyone, right? So let's then take a look really at the map. This is really where the Cold War is important, because looking at Europe after the Second World War, you see how divided the continent really was. Okay? Not only is Germany divided between the three victorious powers and the French. You've got to give the French something because they're going to complain that they don't get something. Okay? But divide Germany up. The three occupational zones in the West, the US, the British, and the French, become what is known as West Germany. Soviet occupational zone becomes East Germany for 45 years. The other countries, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, and Bulgaria, all fall under Soviet occupational spheres, whether they are quisling communist governments or whether they are outright occupied by the Red Army. What matters here is that the Soviet Union extends its sphere of influence into Central Europe. There's two other communist countries that are somehow off on their own doing everything. You have Yugoslavia, which kind of liberated itself without the Soviet help, under the benevolent dictatorship of Tito. Yugoslavian communism kind of does its own hipstery thing for about 45 years until the whole darn thing collapses. And then you have Albania, which was kind of like the North Korea of the Balkans, right? Nobody really paid attention to Albania. It was an incredibly closed-off, isolated communist country. So these guys aren't really going to matter. You also have here a real, this is what we're going to be talking about pretty soon here, the first major conflict between the United States and the Soviet Union was also over the fate of Greece and Turkey. Both countries had significant presence of communist parties. And it was the United States that finally got Stalin to relent on supporting these movements to the point where the Mediterranean and access to the Black Sea was open not only to the West, but to the rest of the world. So it stands then to look at who are the major players, right? Who are the major factions within this larger framework? There's really four. There's four main players. Four main players with a whole bunch of, you know, supporting characters, right? First major player, the United States, obviously, and its allies, its major allies, Great Britain, West Germany, Japan, and France, in that order. As far as the United States is concerned, these were the four key allies that they needed to have. Great Britain, just because, dude, if we can't get Great Britain, we can't get anything else. West Germany, which becomes so strategically, economically, geographically important as far as maintaining security and stability in Europe. Japan, which is to America's interest in the Pacific what Germany's interest was to America in the Atlantic. It was absolutely instrumental that the United States defeat Japan single-handedly. And some historians will make the argument that the reason why Truman ordered the detonation of those two atomic bombs on Japan was not only to end the war quickly, but to prevent Stalin from mobilizing and getting active. Because what he did not want was effectively a division of Japan, as what already happened with Germany. Get Japan to surrender as quickly as possible to the Americans. And throughout the Cold War, Japan became a strategic alliance and a strategic partner to the United States. And finally, France. France was usually the big, you know, backseat driver during this period. The French kind of vacillated between going along with what the Americans said or following their own path. The French were vitally important for a couple of reasons. One, they were in Western Europe. So if you already have Great Britain and West Germany, you're going to need France. Number two, France was a declining colonial power. And what was necessary to happen is that as France was losing its colonies in Western Africa, it was vital that France stay within the Western alliance so, at least hypothetically, they could withdraw from their colonies but leave some kind of functioning quasi-democratic system in place to prevent these colonies from emerging as countries that would then fall under the Soviet sphere of influence. Second major power, obviously, the Soviet Union. And in the same way that the United States had, you know, super friends in the hall of justice, the Soviet Union had the evil bad guys in the hall of doom. Okay? The United States had Western Europe, specifically within a military alliance called NATO, right? I'm sure you're all familiar with that. Soviet Union had Warsaw Pact, which was the communist version of NATO. Poland, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, East Germany, you saw the map. Okay? A later addition to the club was Cuba. Now, nobody thinks of really, you know, including Cuba in anything, but the minute that Cuba goes communist in the late 1950s is one of the first major sobering wake-up calls to the United States, that communism is not simply relegated to East Asia. Communism can be a very potent and very popular political ideology in developing countries, especially countries that have either been colonies of others or are finally emerging with markets and political governance of their own. And the fact that it was only this year that the United States reestablished diplomatic relations with Cuba. It's been 25 years since the Cold War ended, and the United States still sent Cuba to its room to think about what it had done. Okay? So we finally come to the conclusion that Castro is just not going to die easily. Okay? The man has survived God knows how many assassination attempts. Okay? But Cuba was certainly a major, major partner of the Soviet Union during that time. Third one, and I include China not as part of the Soviet sphere of influence, because China first becomes communist in 49, but is seen as a country that, like Yugoslavia, tries to develop communism along its own terms. Sometimes they cooperate with Moscow, other times they go their own path. What the United States realizes by the 1970s, especially after Nixon's so-called secret trip in 74, is that China could possibly be swayed to the other side. They're not going to give up on communism, but they're not necessarily in Moscow's back pocket. China could be an emerging third power. And it won't be until the 1990s that the words Chinese economy are said without snickering and laughing. Okay? During the Cold War, China was an economic basket case, a real undeveloped third world country. But it was also within China that, at least by the Vietnam period, we see that China is also developing its own sphere of influence, particularly in Southeast Asia, whether it's Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos, or other places. And Germany. Germany is important for one very important reason. Whoever controls all of Germany wins the Cold War. That's basically it. Control both of Germany, game over. If West Germany ever falls to the Soviets, game over, Soviets win. If East Germany falls to the United States, game over. Not surprisingly, as soon as the Berlin Wall comes down, Germany reunifies. Here's the thing. The Berlin Wall comes down, November of 1989. Technically, people can travel east to west and west to east. Where do people travel when the wall comes down?
East to west.
They go east to west. There might have been one or two hipsters that wanted to check out what life was like in the east, but more often than not, people went west. Okay? So that's basically the idea there. All right. The goals. The United States and Soviet Union were constantly pursuing these long-term strategic goals to outmaneuver and out-strategize the other. Right? Two terms that we can effectively use that both countries have employed at some point or another. Deterrence and containment. Deterrence is a type of realist foreign policy in which the understanding is rule through fear of force rather than force itself. Especially if you have nuclear weapons. In other words, deterrence is a type of perception that you purposefully project out to the world that your country is powerful, it is armed, it is ready to defend its own interests, and it has absolutely no problem engaging in preemptive warfare if threatened. So the notion of going to war with this country would be absolutely unthinkable, especially if you have nuclear weapons. Having nuclear weapons and going to war with a country with nuclear weapons is suicidal, because there is absolutely no way that you will be able to defeat a country with nuclear weapons, preventing them from some form of retaliation. That's the big thing about both countries having nuclear weapons. The United States could launch all of its nukes against the Soviet Union. Here's the thing. Soviet Union's so damn big that they would have the capability of at least one retaliatory strike. Likewise, Soviet Union could launch all of its missiles against the United States, knowing full well that the United States has large enough territory and enough missiles to survive the first round. So that means nuclear holocaust for both countries. Deterrence in this case is actually, this is actually one of the real ironic things about realism, nuclear deterrence is, ironically and paradoxically, the greatest insurer of peace. Simply because no one wants to fire a shot. Just by the process of knowing that both countries could destroy the planet ensures that war will not happen. Now, is this a safe policy to play? Not really. Is this based on any kind of mutual trust and cooperation? Far from it. Okay? Does it preserve the bipolar status quo? Yes, it does. The United States and the Soviet Union did not go to war with each other. As a matter of fact, the United States and Russia have not gone to war with each other. Hate to break it to anybody who's on Team Ukraine, but that ain't gonna happen. Okay? And it's more to do than just simply nuclear weapons. A second term, and one that came into play after the Cuban Missile Crisis. It's a bit more of a passive strategy, but containment effectively doesn't try to force the other one to back down, but it simply acknowledges that the other side has a sphere of influence. The other side has territory, and it is an accepting of said status quo. Containment is a foreign policy that seeks to limit any additional extent of one's competitor. So containment basically means that the United States accepts that Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union are going to be around for the indefinite future. That's the reason why, ladies and gentlemen, the United States could push strategies of economic development and democracy around the world when they want to. They could especially do this in Western Europe. But one wonders, how come the United States never tried to instigate regime change in Eastern Europe? And the answer is simple, because the United States recognized that that's Russia's territory. Likewise, one could answer, why was it that Stalin and later Soviet party secretaries didn't try to support nascent communist movements in Greece or Turkey or Spain or France or any of these other places, right? They had the money, they had the resources, because the Soviet Union also recognized that that's America's sphere of influence. Recognizing each side's turf, it's almost like, you know, gang warfare, but it's like a Cold War gang warfare, right? You recognize that your turf ends here, your enemies begins there, that's containment. It also perpetuates the status quo. It's not necessarily peaceful. It's not necessarily passive, but it does ensure the lack of war. It does guarantee some kind of stability. Now, the other thing we have to understand about this is that the United States, at least in theory, argued that it is containing the idea of communism. And this becomes definitely apparent by the Eisenhower administration, Kennedy, and the Nixon administration. And yet, we find that America's efforts at containing communism only happened when communism is coming from Moscow. There's no effort at trying to instigate regime change in China, and there's absolutely no problem entertaining Tito whenever he comes to the United States. As a matter of fact, communism in Yugoslavia somehow is able to play both sides rather well. The point here is that you could even go so far as to be communist as long as you were not pro-Moscow communist. If you were communist and you were actually willing to work with the United States, we could even go that far. Which really throws a wrench in the liberalist camp as far as ideology is concerned. But the point to be made here, and again, there's a lot of material that we need to understand before we move on, is that foreign policies of both of these countries operated along these lines of aggressive defense, a way of ensuring the status quo by making the prospect of war highly, highly costly. Okay? So what does that then leave us 45 plus years later, what does that then lead, where does that then leave us? Well, when the dust settles, and we find that the United States emerges, or just happens to win the war by proxy, okay? We find that the United States won that war by creating a system of alliances based upon intercontinental trade and defense of the free world. Right? The United States emerges victorious. Yes, it is a victory for democracy. It's also a victim. It's a victory. Thank you. It's a victory for democracy, and it is also a victory for free market capitalism. We also see that by the 1980s, the United States has created a deep and long-lasting alliance with Europe that remains even until this day. In fact, one of the biggest problems of George W. Bush's attempts at going to war in Iraq in 2003 is not so much because he was violating a whole bunch of UN treaties, but he was also jeopardizing what many European leaders had saw as a long-lasting alliance and partnership with Washington, right? The transatlantic alliance system came the closest to being ruptured in the immediate years following 9/11. It shows you how important that was. Also, with the end of the Cold War, the liberalists do win out by saying principles of commercial pacifism and democratic peace theory do have some validity, okay? Peace in Western Europe is not simply because NATO was there. Peace in Western Europe also comes around because the Germans and the French and the Spanish and the Portuguese and the Italians and the Dutch are actually able to work together. Now, mind you, the realists could say, yeah, they're working together because of American military occupation, keeping everybody in place. Right? Whatever you want to argue, the fact is that Western Europe emerges from the Cold War much more economically stable, much more industrially developed, and much more politically sound than the East does. Which leads us to conclude that whatever alliance system the United States had played remains in force even today. However, the other thing that we get when the Cold War ends is that nuclear weapons are still there. Nuclear weapons are not just in the hands of the United States and the Soviet Union. As a matter of fact, do you know what countries in the world today possess nuclear weapons? We're up to the hard part. US and Russia, what else? China has nuclear weapons. Great Britain has nuclear weapons.
Pakistan and India.
Pakistan and India have nuclear weapons.
France
has nuclear weapons.
Israel
has nuclear weapons, the worst kept secret in the Middle East. But yes, they do have nuclear weapons. And maybe best Korea, we don't know yet. Okay, but damn it, they're trying, okay? And the thing that we get out of this is that a country with nuclear weapons is a country that is taken seriously on the international fronts. Case in point, when the Soviet Union collapses into 15 successor states, you do of course know that it ain't just Russia that suddenly has nuclear weapons, right? You have a whole bunch of other countries, many of which have never existed before, and worse off, their names end in Stan, and they have nuclear power. Should not happen. Kazakhstan should not have nuclear weapons. Ah, high five. Very nice, right? No, okay? We don't want countries like Ukraine, or Pakistan, or Kazakhstan, or Tajikistan, or Pianostan, or Sukhistan, or whatever, to have nuclear weapons. But what it does also show is that the pursuit of it and the creation of it makes you a major force. At least, you're not a country that gets screwed around with, as far as the United States is concerned. Next. What we also get in the wake of the Cold War, and this may have just been coincidental, may not have been an actual product, but in a few short years, the triumph of the free market by 1990 gives way to the age of globalization by the mid-1990s, which has been augmented and best represented by the establishment and the invention, not maybe not so much the invention, but the creation of this one phenomenon that is now widely, almost entirely used by the public. The internet, the age of information, as well. But out of the age of globalization, the age of the internet, and the age of information, also comes the age of global terror. This is something we're going to be talking about at the end of the semester, but it's worth pointing out right now. Global terror networks certainly existed during the Cold War. Many of these global terror networks were created because of certain political and strategic moves that either Washington or Moscow had done. Many of them still exist today. Others have morphed into far more aggressive, more expansionist organizations. Okay? ISIS is a product of the insurgency of Iraq of the previous decade. That insurgency is a product of Al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda is a product of the Afghanistani Mujahideen of the 1980s, when the Soviets invaded Afghanistan and the United States threw money at any group of people that were willing to fight against the Red Army. Okay? So what we also see is that the Cold War gives us many of the reasons, many of the points of post-Cold War conflicts today. And it's not just global terror. It's also the persistence of non-democratic regimes in the Middle East, the spreading of conflict that started first from Arab Spring, but now has morphed into a huge refugee crisis coming out of countries like Syria and Iraq. Large transnational debts, mostly incurred by the United States, a major economic explosion of ideas and industries coming out of China, and the persistence of North Korea as one of the constant reminders that there are some pockets of the world where people still think the Cold War exists. So with that in mind, it's also worth taking a sort of a preemptive observation that the perceptions that had emerged, the perceptions of one country to another that had formed during the Cold War is a very constructivist approach. Okay? When you look at the way in which the Cold War had shaped itself, and you kind of rationalize why the United States made the decisions that it did, why the Soviet Union made the decisions that it did. Constructivists are going to look at this and they're going to give a lot of points. They're going to give a lot of credit to the neorealists. They're going to totally understand. They're going to totally be like, all right, bipolar system, I get it. Thank you, Ken Waltz. But you're also going to have to understand that these are two hegemonic countries operating under two significantly different values. That's also a nod to the liberalists. Ideology does come into play in the Cold War. The United States may not have known what it was fighting for. The United States may not have known what it was fighting in the name of, but we sure were sure of what we were fighting against. We knew what our enemy was, whether it was communism, whether it was, you know, Soviet planned economies, whether it was state atheism, whatever it happened to have been. If you ascribe to the belief that the United States won the Cold War through soft power, through products and movies and soft drinks and Big Macs and Mickey Mouse and Disney World, you have to understand a good chunk of this consumerist sector was largely funded and supported as a way of selling an idea, selling an image of America against the Soviet Union. Okay? When you've come home from a long day at work in America, you want to refresh yourself, what do you have? A nice big tall glass of Coca-Cola. Yes. What do you have in Russia? You either have beet juice or vodka. Okay? That's it. In America, we have the California coast, we have Disney World, we have the Rocky Mountains. In Soviet Union, you have tundra, it's cold. Okay? In America, you have Technicolor. In Soviet Union, everything black and white. It was an image game. It was an absolute image game. Go see the Rambo movies, the Iron Eagle movies. Let's see Rocky IV. America was really upset that we never went to war with the Soviet Union. We made a movie about it. This is sort of the ice hockey 1980s Olympic match between the Soviet Union. Absolutely. So, yes, there were degrees of uncertainty. And yes, there was imperfect information. That much was certain. Okay? But that information and those misperceptions were largely fueled by different values and prejudices. Absolutely, no question about it. And you have to also understand, US foreign policy was geared to be specifically against whatever the Soviet Union was doing. More so than what the Soviet Union was doing by the Americans. Okay? It also is painfully obvious that whereas the United States may have been in working, operating in defense of freedom or whatever it was really doing so to contain Soviet Russia. We have absolutely no problem doing business with communist China. And while they were alive and working, we had no problem with communist Yugoslavia as well. Note, even today, we have absolutely no problem working with communist China, but yet it still is a sensitive subject for many politicians in this country to engage with some kind of relation with communist Cuba or communist Vietnam. Why is that? Because communist Cuba is a product of Soviet Union, and communist Vietnam, well, you all remember the Vietnam War, okay? So ideology does get personal, and that was certainly defined by that.